I got up out of the bed and went down the stairs, and I turned to the living room, but I seen my daddy lying on the floor. His eyes were closed and there was lots of people in the room, but I couldn't really see the people in the room. I was just looking at my daddy.
I felt all this glass coming in all over my face and the loudness of a bang. I looked at my dad and it was just blood everywhere, all over his whole face, body, and all over me. And I was just getting glimpses of him because of the glass. And I was calling his name and I was saying, "Daddy, Daddy."
I could see, you know, the wounds on his body, you know, the blood, and there was blood splattered just everywhere. He started to fall asleep, and the neighbour had said to me, you know, get a pillow for his head, and he was telling him not to go to sleep, and, you know, he did, and, you know, he just lay there.
Well, devastated my family, to be honest. When I look back on it now, I actually consider myself lucky in a way, because I was so young when it happened. And because I was so young, I wasn't actually used to, you know, as I grew older, I didn't really get to know my mother, so, you know, it didn't affect me as badly as it would have affected my grandparents or my stepfather, because, you know, they actually had a chance to get to know my mother, whereas I didn't really. I only knew her, you know, as a kid, and to be honest, I can't really even remember her now, you know.
Collusion has been part of the 6th county state since its creation. Since then, successive unionist governments have relied on its armed militias, the B Specials, the RUC, and the unionist paramilitary death squads, to enforce its rule on the people of the North. The 1960s saw a heightened sectarian campaign by unionist paramilitaries and their political masters, aimed at destroying the growing demand for equality and civil rights by the nationalist community. By the time the British state retook control of the 6 counties, after the pogroms of August 1969, collusion was already an established policy, the origins of which can be traced to Brigadier Frank Kitson, who refined and adapted British counterinsurgency policies to suit what he saw as the situation in the North. Kitson said, "The law should be used as just another weapon in the government's arsenal, and in this case, it becomes little more than a propaganda cover for the disposal of unwanted members of the public."
There can be no compromise or concession to the enemy that assails our province today. We must build up the dossiers on the men and women who are a menace to this country. Because one day, ladies and gentlemen, if the politicians fail, it may be our job to liquidate the enemy.
During the 1970s, some of the most horrific atrocities were carried out by unionist death squads under the control of British military intelligence. These included no warning car bombs, random sectarian assassinations, many of which were carried out in the most brutal fashion. This murder campaign was deliberately sanctioned and aimed to terrorise the entire nationalist community into relinquishing their demands for an end to partition and for basic civil and human rights. When Margaret Thatcher came to power in 1979, the policy of collusion became a much more controlled and refined weapon in the British government's arsenal in Ireland. Specific mechanisms were established to control and direct the Loyalist death squads.
The first memory when I heard of her death was disbelief and doubt that it wasn't her. Then when I got to the family home and I seen all the people there, and it was like an out-of-body experience. You just could not describe it. No police came to our house to inform our family that Philomena was murdered. There was no police liaison officer with our family to tell us what was going on. And that's what struck me, that the police did not inform the family officially. And my father had to go and identify my sister. And my sister had 5 bullets in the face, 1 in the chest. And when he went to identify my sister, he fell on top of her and was crying, "Philomena, Philomena." And when he came back, the thing that I noticed most about him, he had blood on his shirt where he had fallen on top of Philomena, because all she had was a sheet from her shoulders down, and the blood obviously was seeping through.
I was in a neighbour's house next door to my granny's house, who minded me when my mother was at work. And I was just sitting playing away with her, and went out and looked out her window and just seen cars all over the street. But we were told to go back into the living room, and then about 10 minutes later my daddy came in and sat me on his knee and just explained what had happened to mummy. On the day that she was killed, I was actually making my first communion 2 weeks later, and that's all I could say. She's not going to see me in my communion dress.
It's just a normal day, and we just locked up as usual, locked the house up as usual. We do every night and went to bed. About 10 past 4 in the morning, I heard voices outside the door. So I got up and looked out the bedroom window and seen an army food patrol. They had been radioing to the registration number of his car. So I got it back into bed, not thinking anything of it. Within 10 minutes, the door was sledgehammered down, and 5 gunmen came in, run up our stairs. And by that time, Gerard had got out of bed. He had heard the noise, and he seen the gunmen coming up the stairs, and he shouted to me, "Teresa, the orange man." He tried to fight them off down the stairs with a stepladder that we had for to get up into his space. But all I could hear was shots. I seen smoke and flashes. And I was trying to protect the kids because I was afraid of them coming in the bedroom. So I threw myself over the kids, and everything seemed to have gone quiet. But you could still smell smoke. And when I went out on the lantern, Jart was lying there, and the blood was everywhere. It actually pumped holes everywhere in his body.
I heard this after it, that the fellow who was in the back of the car, John, had taken his hand and he said, "Are you all right?" And the fella said, you know, that the blood was just everywhere. It was, you know, it was a terrible, terrible scene. And one of the fellas had actually tried to get out of the car and run, and he'd been shot then as he was, you know, getting over a wall on the other side of the road. So the cops then had been informed, and the ambulance had came. And John was taken to the hospital, and then he was pronounced dead. And my parents were informed, all of the rest of my family were informed, but I wasn't. I found out that he had been killed by the media. I heard his name on the radio. That day, you know, with all the security force, you know, activity that was around, there was absolutely no way that anybody could just have come into that area, into, you know, a very strongly Republican nationalist area, and gunned down 4 people without the help of somebody somewhere.
Central to the policy of collusion was Brian Nelson. Nelson was a British agent placed inside the UDA. He rose within its ranks and became their top intelligence officer. At this level, he controlled all intelligence information used in identifying targets for UDA and other unionist paramilitary death squads. Attempts were made on the lives of at least 80 people listed in Nelson's target files. 29 were shot dead. Brian Nelson was charged with 5 of these murders. Michael Parr, Francisco Notar Antonio, Jared Slane, Pat Finucane, Terry McDade. Nelson's role in these murders was covered up by the then Prime Minister, John Major, who prior to Nelson's trial met the trial judge, Basil Kelly, and the head of the British judiciary in the north, Chief Judge Brian Hutton.
We went to the court and we sat through what Brian Nelson was involved in, and you're just so angry at that this man could have done this and he could get away with it. And even after, when they said the charges were dropped against him, you were asking yourself why. Was it because he was a British Army's intelligence officer, and that's why, if it had been anybody else, he wouldn't have got away with what he had did, like?
The British Army's Force Reconnaissance Unit, better known as FRU, had the authority to ensure loyalist gunmen had a clear run to and from their target. All British military and police patrols were withdrawn from the designated areas, leaving a free run for the assassins.
The army, if they wish, can act extremely quickly. If they have knowledge of a terrorist attack or something big going down, a bomb or something like that, they are on the scene immediately. They will stake it out, they will deploy their people, they will be patient if necessary. If they have to act within the hour, they will be there within the hour. They can do it, they have all the resources at their fingertips, every single solitary one. And there was no reason, absolutely no reason, for them not to do something with the information that they had, not only about my husband, but they had information about lots of other people. And they let them die.
In late 1987, a number of unionist paramilitary groups, the UDA, the UVF, and Ulster Resistance, a recently founded unionist paramilitary group under the control and influence of Ian Paisley, cooperated to import a consignment of modern weapons into the north. Central to this operation were a number of British agents working in both South Africa and within the loyalist groups, including Brian Nelson. Within 6 years of the arrival of these weapons, loyalist murder gangs had increased their capacity to kill by 300%. In the 6 years prior to the weapons shipment, unionist death squads killed 71 people. In the subsequent 6 years, they killed 229.
From John was killed, I myself have got married and have had three children, and you know, I feel that is an awful loss, that he has never known them, or they have never got to know them. The kind of person that he was, or the uncle that he could have been, or the father that he could have been himself.
Well, it's hard bringing three kids up on your own, especially around their birthdays and first communions. I think would have been the hardest. Christmas, first Christmas was really, really hard. So it's really Christmas and holiday times where you're expected to go away as a family. You're expected the father to be there for them when they're making their first communion, their confirmation, and be there for Christmas morning when they're opening their presents. It's been really hard.
Well, the impression I get from my outer family of mother is that she was very energetic. She was always on the move. She's a very cheery, happy person. She always wanted to better herself. That's why she went back to school. She was a single mother. She had me at a very early age, but she decided at the age of, I think it was 25, 26, to go to university and get a law degree.
It's been devastating. 8 months after Philomena was murdered, my father was found dead in his bed on Christmas Day. He was taunted constantly by the British Army any time he went onto the street about Philomena. And he then stopped. He used to go for walks, maybe over to the graveyard or up to the top of the White Rock. And when that started with the British Army, he stopped going out. He then died, as I said, on Christmas Day of a broken heart.
The Inurnia campaign began in 2001 when a group of relatives who had lost loved ones as a direct result of Collusion came together. The help and support that Inurnia has received and given has created a sense of unity among many of the relatives and friends of victims of Collusion. To date, Inurnia has been involved in numerous activities to highlight its campaign. In February 2004, over 70 relatives travelled to London, where they held protests outside MI5 and Conservative Party headquarters.
We're hoping to show the British government that we are not going to let the murder of our loved ones go on unnoticed, and we hope the British government face up to the responsibilities and give us an investigation into the murder.
We hope to find out why the British government permitted our loved ones to be murdered.
Well, I mean, obviously we're all in the same boat. I was very young when this happened, but now I think by doing this and taking a stand and making them know that we're not going to let it go, you know, and before people like Thatcher die, and hopefully they'll get their comeuppance.
Well, what I know what today achieved, it sent a very powerful message to the British establishment that with all the families who had lost loved ones through British collusion and British state violence, that we are a powerful unit together, and we showed today that we can be together and united. And that unity will only grow in strength and in numbers in the short to long term period to come.
Well, I hope the British government will take into consideration that the forces that they employ have been murdering Catholic people in Northern Ireland since for 30 years, actually. And there has been no prosecutions of any member of the security forces. They set my son up, the UDR, set my son up to be murdered.
The British government has never accepted its responsibility for the death of our loved ones, and the politicians who sanctioned the policy of collusion have never been made accountable. The aims of Inurnia, which is a campaign for the truth about collusion between British state agencies and unionist death squads in the killing of citizens in Ireland, are as follows. To see the policy of collusion ended. To obtain full disclosure of all information on the British government's policy of collusion. To achieve the dismantling of all structures and agencies which implemented this policy of state murder. For the families and friends of those murdered through collusion, its effects are still felt. Every day they live with the reality of what collusion means.
My name's Kitty Hannah. My mummy was killed on the Springfield Road. I miss her very much. And I never got to call her mummy or nothing. And I can't remember. It feels like I didn't even have a mummy. I don't know.
Kitty, I'm not going to ask you to say anything else, darling. I don't think you could say that in the bathroom. Thanks very much. That's all you need to say.